Good morning, Zion. You belong here. We belong together. I'm Pastor Dwayne Jesse, pastor of Zion Lutheran Church in Youngstown, Ohio, and today we are celebrating the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. And happy Independence Day weekend to you as well. I hope your festivities are safe and relaxing. Zion Lutheran Church is hosting live in-person corporate worship, and I want you to feel welcome to attend either our blended service on Saturday at 5 p.m. or our traditional Lutheran liturgical service on Sunday morning at 9:30 a.m. The church office will be closed this Monday in observance of Independence Day. Carol and I will be on vacation this next weekend and most of the week following. However, I have already recorded the service for the weekend of July the 11th, including my inspiring sermon. So if you don't get to worship with us live at Zion, I'll still be coming to you on your electronic devices. Zion next drive-through dinner will be this Thursday, July the 15th, and will feature meatloaf and mashed potatoes. Now, I've had this meal and it is so good that Carol and I will be back in town in time to pick up our meals on Thursday evening. To reserve yours, I would encourage you to go to the website zionohio.org and click on the Give tab, or you can call the office to reserve your meals. I want to thank you for your continued financial faithfulness. Zion continues to be a vital part of this community due to your regular contributions. The special ministry emphasis for the month of July is local benevolence, which is a fund out of which we support other local parachurch ministries and also Zion's food distribution. To make a special offering to either one of those causes or to contribute your regular tithes and offerings, I would encourage you to go to the website zionohio.org and click on the Give tab. You can also use the Give Plus smartphone app, or you can reach us by the U.S. mail. Assisting in worship today are Joan Gent, our administrator of worship and music, on the keyboards. Carrie Jennings will be leading us in our singing and providing special music. Ellie Orr will be leading us in our prayers of intercession. Eric Vargo edited the video. Stephanie Chismar edited the music. And Kari Wenz, our administrator of communications, produced the video. Now, I invite you to please join in singing our gathering song. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. God of the covenant, in our baptism you call us to proclaim the coming of your kingdom. Give us the courage you gave the apostles, that we may faithfully witness to your love and peace in every circumstance of life. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. A reading from Ezekiel. A voice said to me, O mortal, stand up on your feet, and I will speak with you. And when he spoke to me, a spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard him speaking to me. He said to me, Mortal, I am sending you to the people of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants are impudent and stubborn. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God, whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that there has been a prophet among them. The word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that he has been given? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here among us? And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could not do any deeds of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord. Nazareth was Jesus' hometown. Today, Nazareth is the Arab capital of Israel and is a city of over 77,000 people. In Jesus' day, it was a town of less than 2,000 people. By comparison, New Springfield has a population of about 1,600 people. North Jackson has a population of about 3,000 people. So imagine a town between those two sizes. If you're familiar with those towns and can imagine a much less mobile society, then you might be able to imagine that everyone in first century Nazareth knew everyone else. Jesus, for example, was the oldest son of Mary. Unless you're Catholic, and then he would be the only son of Mary, and then you're stuck trying to figure out who was the mother of James, Joseph, Judas, Simon, and their sisters. On a similar note, the reason Bible scholars presume that Joseph was much older than Mary is that he's never heard from again after the story of Jesus being left in the temple in Jerusalem at the Passover. Scholars believe that he died sometime after that, but not before passing on his trade of carpentry to his son Jesus. But I digress. The point is that Nazareth is a town small enough that everyone knew everyone else, and their business, if you know what I mean. Just what happened to Jesus between those very few stories of his youth and when he reappeared at his baptism by John and began calling disciples is a source of much speculation. And it goes like this. Jesus grew up the firstborn son of Mary and her husband Joseph and learned the trade of carpentry from his earthly father. Sometime after that, Jesus left home and may have joined the Essenes, a sect of Judaism that flourished between the 2nd century BCE and the 1st century CE, where he may have gotten enough training that people began to call him rabbi. However, I speculate that Jesus did not see the Essenes, who were ascetic, communal, and nearly monastic, as the embodiment of the abundant life that God his Father had sent him to preach. Regardless of where he had been, what Scripture tells us is that at about 30 years of age, he reappeared on the public scene preaching that the kingdom of God had come near. This passage that is our gospel reading for today is Jesus' second visit back to his hometown of Nazareth since beginning his public ministry. His first visit was back in chapter 3, according to Mark's gospel, and that visit was controversial too. You might recall that story was the gospel reading back on the first weekend in June. Though he had sent his disciples out on their first ministry journey without him, when he arrived in Nazareth, a large crowd of his second-tier disciples accompanied him. And that must have been alarming to his family because Mark wrote that they, his family, tried to restrain him. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem accused him of being Beelzebul, another name for Satan. So that visit, two chapters ago, did not go well. But that seems to not have deterred him because in our gospel reading for today, two chapters later, he returned. This time he came with his disciples in tow. He went to the synagogue, as was his custom, and he began to teach. Initially, it would appear that they were impressed, saying, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" Remember last week how I said that text does not emote? This text is an example of that because we might think that they were impressed by Jesus. And on the contrary, the truth is they were offended. Notice that last phrase, and they took offense at him. So on this second visit, in a very short time, Jesus was still not welcome. They were not going to ascribe to him messianic faith and belief to a man who was one of them. They had watched him grow up. "No, sir, you are Mary's son. How dare you come among us claiming to be more than you are?" Notice, Jesus didn't get upset. I'm sure he was disappointed. Who wouldn't want to do something nice in their own hometown? Mark concluded he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. Yeah, he just cured a few people. In stark contrast to Jesus' inability to do much good in his own hometown, In the second half of the gospel reading, we have his disciples out on their second missionary trip without him. Now, mind you, the disciples had only been with Jesus a short while, perhaps a year, and yet they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. What is going on here? I'm so glad you asked. I don't want you to think that somehow Jesus was less powerful because he was among his own disbelieving and faithless townsfolk. I think it would be wrong-headed to think that we sinful people can disrupt the power of God revealed in Jesus Christ. But I do think that God revealed in Jesus Christ chooses to work with people who want to work with him. For example, in last week's gospel reading, we had two cases. Jairus, the leader of the synagogue, who wanted healing for his daughter and got it through Jesus. When everyone else gave up, Jesus said, "Do not fear, only believe." And we have the story of the hemorrhaging woman who wanted healing for herself and got it through Jesus. She did not intend to attract attention to herself, but when Jesus felt that power go out from him, he told the woman, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." And in the second half of the gospel reading for today, the disciples, who were relatively new in their calling and hadn't even really figured out who Jesus was yet, went out proclaiming that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. I am certain that Jesus wanted to do good work in his own hometown. Just imagine. But whether he would have or because he didn't, the result was the same. They took offense, spoke ill of him behind his back, and refused his message that was meant to bring wholeness both physically and spiritually. And because of their own ignorance or foolishness or lack of humility or discernment, they failed to see Jesus for who he truly was and missed out on what could have been the greatest day in Nazareth's history. What's the difference? An openness to the ministrations of the Holy Spirit of God revealed in Jesus Christ. I entitled this sermon, "Impressed or Inspired?" Because this gospel reading points out that every person who has an encounter with Jesus has to decide for themselves whether to simply be impressed, as though Jesus was a magician who could perform magic tricks but essentially leaves us unchanged, or are we inspired, meaning that we are convinced by virtue of his ministry of preaching and teaching and performing signs and miracles that he has the power of the Spirit of God in him and inspires us to seek that same Spirit of God so that we can do powerful ministry in his name. Like the people of Nazareth and the people of the villages his disciples ministered to, we have a choice. Are we impressed or are we inspired? Zion, and here I am talking about our members and our visitors alike, let us not miss out on the opportunity to enjoy the abundant life that Jesus came to reveal. Jesus wants it for you and for me and for all people. But like the free COVID-19 vaccine, some people just refuse the gift. Jesus continues to do great deeds of power and gives us, his disciples, authority too. Yet none of this power is arbitrary. It must be administered through faith. Jesus asked his disciples to go out without money or supplies so that they, one, will be dependent on the Spirit of God for their well-being, And two, that the people they minister to will receive, which is also through the Spirit of God. When we are sent from this assembly to witness, to heal, to feed, to serve, to teach, to minister, we do so with faith, the belief that the Spirit always operates between Jesus and us, and between us and those whom we are sent to minister to. We have nothing to fear, and only good work to be done in His name. Let us pray about that. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, in our baptism you call us to proclaim the coming of your kingdom. Let us not simply be impressed by the stories we read in Holy Scripture, but let us be inspired to faithfully witness to your love, grace, and mercy wherever we are sent. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We have been made God's people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us come before the triune God in prayer.
God of salvation, we pray for churches around the world. Sustain those churches that experience persecution or harassment, and give wisdom to churches in free societies that we might live according to your word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of creation, we pray for your earth. Protect the natural beauty in our national and local parks and forests, and guide the decisions of all who care for and work on the land. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of righteousness, we pray for the nations. Bestow your peace throughout the world. Raise up prophets to speak truth to power. Uphold those who work for human rights, and protect the poor and the refugee. On this 4th of July, we ask that you bless the United States, free us from prejudices, and grant to our elected leaders a passion for justice and a will to serve all the people. Protect from danger those who celebrate this day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, we pray for the sick and suffering, for the victims of disasters, for all Indigenous peoples around the globe, for those deprived of their freedom, for those facing the Delta COVID contagion, and especially those on our prayer list, our homebound, and those we now name before you, either silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of eternal love, we thank you for all your saints, those who have served their nation and those who ministered beyond national boundaries. At the end of all things, bring us all into the kingdom of your presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your abiding grace. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now please join in singing our sending hymn. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon us now and forever. Amen. You belong here. We belong together. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.